Welcome to Summer Reading 2014. I'm Maureen Plour, NHS Library Media Specialist, along with my colleague, fellow NHS Media Specialist, Mr. Brian Hartley, and we're joined today by Ms. Bailey Ortiz and Ms. Alyssa LaCrosse from the Lucy Robbins Welles Public Library. For the next half hour or so, we'll be sharing some great titles for summer reading with you. So let's get started. We're going to begin with memoirs or true stories. The first one on my list is Whatever You Do, Don't Run, True Tales of a Botswana Safari Guide by Peter Allison. The author, Peter Allison, left Australia at the age of 19 to go backpack through Africa. What started as a one-year vacation turned into 7 years of guiding safaris. It's a really fun and funny memoir where Allison shares his experiences taking guests through the African wilderness on trips that often don't go quite as planned, especially due to the unpredictability of the wild animals, but more often due to the stupidity of the guests he brings. What I really liked is that it's a constant battle between instinct and common sense. Peter Allison really makes fun of himself and everyone else. The book will take you places that you'll probably never see in your lifetime, so if you like entertaining, funny, adventurous, and dangerous, it's a great pick. The second book that I've chosen is called The Pact. Three young men make a promise to fulfill a dream. This is the story of Samson Davis, George Jenkins, and Ramek Hunt, who grew up in impoverished, broken families in public housing projects in Newark, New Jersey. Both Davis and Hunt actually served time in juvenile jails during the time between their junior and senior years. When Jenkins, who had a dream of becoming a dentist, learned about a program that Seton Hall was offering for minority students who were interested in medical careers, he convinced his two friends to apply, and they vowed to make a pact that to get each other through. So despite tremendous distractions and difficulties, two today are doctors and one's a dentist. So it's really a story about the potential in all of us. These boys didn't even dare to dream of being doctors. It wasn't even within their realm of understanding. But each one graduated and each one went back to the same neighborhood and is currently practicing there. Great inspirational story. Bailey, what did you pick?
I chose Dear Nobody. We get a lot of teens who like to read Go Ask Alice. It actually gets stolen a lot at our library. And Dear Nobody just came or was just released, and it follows Mary Rose, and it's between the years of 15 and 18. And it's really graphic, but it's also about just her struggle with cystic fibrosis, and also her experience with drugs, alcohol, her fights with her mom, and of course romance. And her voice was so powerful that the editors that released this spent 5 years in court and $35,000 to bring it to books, so it's pretty intense. And then my second one is Life After Death, which is actually about the West Memphis Three, or one of the boys of the West Memphis Three. They were three teenage boys who were arrested, this was in the 90s, suspected for murdering 3 8-year-old boys. And so, and it was believed that there was satanic rituals involved. They later had their trial or retrial, and they were released. And so Damien Echols is the one who was put on death row when he was 18. He was the only one put on death row. And so this is a story about life during prison, life after prison. And there are some people who still believe that they actually did it. So it's pretty interesting. And I do have a trailer of a movie that's coming out called Devil's Knot that actually shares the story.
He went out riding bikes with Michael, but I told him he better be home by 4:30.
I don't see the boy nowhere.
Stevie! Come on home!
We are doing everything we can.
My son is 8 years old!
We have three boys missing from Holiday Garden. It's a very delicate situation.
I'm in the woods by that little creek they call Devil's Den. I found something.
Damien Jackals Jason Baldwin and Jesse Miss Kelly will be charged in the murders of the three boys we found last month in the Robin Hood Woods.
Apparently, some residents suspect a satanic cult is responsible.
They look like freaks. You don't look like that when you're like a normal person.
My name's Ron Lax. I'm an investigator.
This crime is unthinkable. What if they did it?
And what if they didn't? Did you kill any of those three boys?
No.
Anytime anything weird happens around here, people blame it on devil worshippers.
Did you ever find any evidence or anything to link these murders to Damien?
Why a sentence should not be imposed?
Because I'm innocent.
There was blood on the knife.
They will do anything to get people to say what they want to hear.
Killing 3 8-year-olds would make you feel good.
Whoever did it must have.
Satanism is out there.
The police, the judge, everybody. This is all just some sort of game to them.
Whatever it takes.
Might be able to prove the cops never really tried to find out who did.
Would you want 3 more families to lose their children to?
I don't know anymore.
You know, Bailey, I remember when that happened, and the public outcry at that time was just tremendous. Troubling book. Mr. Hartley, I believe you're up next.
Yes, my first one's a little more lighthearted. One shot at forever, a small town, an unlikely coach in a magical baseball season. This is just a great underdog story about a high school baseball team from a tiny town called Macon, Illinois, and their very quirky, unorthodox coach, who was an English teacher, no coaching experience, this guy named Lynn Sweet. The story takes place back in 1971 and just follows this remarkable season in which this kind of ragtag team takes on the real giants of Illinois high school baseball at the time. The writer, who works for Sports Illustrated, traces the story all the way up to the present, where he catches up with the coach and the players. And in addition to the story itself being interesting, it's interesting how those individuals kind of look back at it and how that those events 30, 40 years earlier impacted their lives today. My second one on the memoir list is called Never Fall Down by Patricia McCormick. This is both a National Book Award finalist as well as on the Nutmeg list this year. Patricia McCormick, really well known for books like Sold, Cut, and My Brother's Keeper. Although she's the author, the story is really told through the voice and is the story of a Cambodian man named Arn, who at 11 years old is when the Khmer Rouge came to power in Cambodia in 1975, and this radical communist group undertook this massive genocide. They killed upwards of 2 million Cambodians over the next 4 years. Again, and Arn is 11 years old when this ensues. So it's really his story of survival through the brutal conditions that the Khmer Rouge put the Cambodian people under. The story follows Arn all the way to America, where he enters a high school, regular high school, at 15, 16 years old, in his effort to kind of adapt and then ultimately as an adult become a spokesperson for his country. So that was a really, really good story.
Okay, I believe you're up now with LaCrosse.
All right, my first pick is Discovering Westmore. It's the story of two boys with the same name and similar past. One graduated with honors from military school and was the first African-American graduate of Johns Hopkins to become a Rhodes Scholar. The other, Westmore, landed in prison, where he is serving a life sentence for murder. Both men were children of single mothers who worked hard to keep their sons out of trouble and keep food on the table. Find out where and when their paths diverged. My second pick is called Without a Net. It's by Michelle Kennedy. It's the story of Michelle, who dropped out of college at age 19 and married her high school sweetheart. She becomes a middle-class housewife of 3 children. Her husband decides to move the family to a cabin in rural Maine that has no running water or electricity. After he neglects to watch their children and their daughter almost dies in an accident, Michelle and the kids go off on their own. So at age 25, she finds herself living in a station wagon with her 3 young children, making pots of ramen noodles at campgrounds, and showering at truck stops. Michelle struggles to find affordable childcare and an apartment as she waitresses for $2 an hour. Along the way, you'll meet all the people who help her improvise through this hard time, including a love interest that brightens the suspense story while you're rooting for Michelle to win.
Wow. All right, we're going to move from real-life stories to realistic fiction. And Miss Ortiz is going to start us off with her picks.
The first one I chose is Side Effects May Vary which is the story of 6-year-old Alice. She's diagnosed with leukemia. And everyone, as awful as it sounds, is kind of waiting for her to die, herself especially. And so she puts together this bucket list with one of her good friends, and it also kind of includes acts of revenge against those who have wronged her, since she figures she has nothing left to lose, except she surprises everyone and goes into remission. So now she has to live with the consequences of everything that she just did. And so she's not really a likable character in some ways, but you kind of want to see how everything plays out, so I really enjoyed this story. And then my second one is Dare Me by Eric Devine, and it kind of reminds me of an old TV show on MTV. Ben and his two friends decide to have this epic senior year, and they're going to complete a series of dares and post videos on YouTube, essentially. And they keep their faces hidden so no one knows who they are, but they just want to go down in history. Their first video has to do with car surfing, and so it goes viral, and everyone's talking about it, and the authorities are trying to figure out who they are. And then all of a sudden a mysterious sponsor appears out of nowhere, they don't know who he is, and offers them money to do things that grow in the level of dangerousness. So it gets a little bit more intense because right away a stunt goes bad and some of the boys want to back out, but their leader won't let them, and they all need the money, and you'll find out in the book for various reasons, desperately. So it gets a little out of control, but there is a lot of action, and it's a pretty interesting read.
Sounds like a cautionary tale.
Yeah.
Mr. Hartley.
The first one on my realistic fiction list is My Book of Life by Angel. This is a novel, a lyrical novel, so it's written in verse, which definitely kind of impacts the way the story reads, I think. It's of a 16-year-old girl named Angel. Angel meets this guy named Call, who's very nice to her and buys her things, but gradually helps her get addicted to drugs. And before long, Angel is working the streets of Vancouver, Canada as a prostitute. The backdrop to the story is actually a real series of murders of prostitutes in Vancouver, Canada that took place over the 1980s and 90s. So it's a story of really her survival and struggle to try to kind of get out of this cycle that she's in. There are many stories that have been done really well about drug addiction and surviving life on the streets, and I think the element that makes this one unique is that the style in which it's written, that lyrical novel that kind of really gives the story kind of a rhythm to it, and it reads pretty quickly and interestingly. And I think this is another Nutmeg nominee on the list this year. And secondly for me in realistic fiction is Final Four by Paul Volpone. Paul Volpone has been a pretty popular author recently. Some titles such as Riker's High and Rooftop have gone out a lot for us, I know. This is a fictional account of NCAA basketball's Final Four. The story alternates kind of chapter to chapter between a few different main characters, including like a freshman phenom who everyone knows is going to go pro after his freshman year, a player from Eastern Europe who has made his way to America to play, and a player named Michael Jordan, who, although he's a basketball player, is not the Michael Jordan, which doesn't make his life very easy. Interesting read, you know, kind of takes you behind the scenes of the Final Four from multiple perspectives, but also tackles issues such as paying college athletes, which has been in the news recently. So it's definitely an interesting read on the Nutmeg list here as well.
Nice. I knew we could expect a sports story from
two,
you.
Two, I believe.
Two. Miss LaCrosse.
My first pick is Looking for Alaska, of course, by John Green, who's ever popular right now.
I have a book by him on my list.
Yep. It's the story of a 16-year-old boy named Miles, who's nicknamed Pudge, who leads a boring life until he decides to attend boarding school in Alabama, where he sees his great perhaps. While he's there, he meets Alaska, who's a reckless and adventurous girl, and he instantly falls in love with her. The characters all engage in plotting elaborate pranks and making trouble around campus. You'll love the sarcastic humor of Pudge and the spirit and energy of Alaska as they embark on the biggest and best prank in the history of their school. My second pick is If I Stay, and it grabs readers within the first 10 pages of the book. Right at the start of the book, the main character, a talented cellist, Mia, who's dating a boy in a rock band, which is very contrasting, she's in a horrible accident, and it separates her spirit from her body, and as she's in a coma, she watches and reflects on what's happening with her family while she's in the hospital. So if she lives, will she go on to Juilliard, or will she stay in Oregon to be with her boyfriend Adam? And the book is actually going to be a movie this summer, so we have the trailer.
I figured, you know, if you look at it every night, it won't seem so scary when you get there.
I told you he was into you.
No, he isn't. You know how when you meet someone and they just already are the person they're meant to be? That was Adam. Nobody outside Portland had ever heard of his band, but he already was somebody. Me, not so much.
She shouldn't be scared to hang out with those guys. They're us.
Exactly.
Adam's here.
Kids, be careful out there. Here it gets pretty wild with Symphony.
Why do I have this feeling you're lost of my entire life?
You can't hide in that rehearsal room forever. It's too late. I see you.
Isn't it amazing how life is one thing and then in an instant it becomes something else? Like here I am, Mia, the girl who thinks about the cello and Adam, and just like that.
You live, if you die, it's all up to you. So whatever fight you got in you, you gotta pull it out now.
Say something, I'm giving up on you.
Kid's waking up an orphan. If she wakes up.
Say something, I'm giving up on you.
What am I supposed to do?
Sometimes you make choices in life, and sometimes choices make you.
This.
The you are now is the same you I was in love with yesterday, the same you I'll be in love with tomorrow.
You still have a family, Mia.
I can't lose her.
Say something.
Why me? Life is this big, fat, gigantic, stinking mess. That's the beauty of it, too.
I'm still here, and I'm crazy in love with you. Please stay.
Bailey, the first book that I chose for realistic fiction is one that we read with book club a few years ago called The Language of Flowers by Vanessa Diffenbaugh. That was one of my favorites. The main character, Victoria, is now 18 years old, and she's been emancipated from the foster care system where she spent most of her life. But she has nowhere to go, and she ends up sleeping in a public park where she actually plants a small garden, and a local florist discovers her talents. And Victoria realizes she has a gift for helping others through the flowers that she chooses and arranges for them. So she starts to work at the flower shop, and she meets Grant, who's really the only person that she feels truly understands her. And it makes her start to question all the things that are missing in her life. And it's really at that point that you begin to get details of what her life was like and what painful secret that she's had in her life that's prevented her from really believing that she can be or even deserves to be happy. What I really liked about this one is it's told in alternating chapters between the present and events that happened when she was 10 years old, which was really the last time that she had a chance to really be incorporated into a family and a so-called normal life. So the story is kind of heartbreaking and a disturbing look at what could happen to children in foster care. Now the second one that I have is a John Green book as well. And it's called The Fault in Our Stars, which has been very popular in our library. We just got the second copy. And I have to say, I really wasn't sure I wanted to read the book. You know, a book about two teenagers with cancer. I thought it was going to be depressing. I thought it was going to be predictable. But it was totally neither of those things. We have 16-year-old Hazel, who's living tethered to an oxygen tank. She's got stage 4 thyroid cancer. It's in remission due to constant chemotherapy that she's undergoing, but she feels like she's living life in slow motion now, until she meets Augustus Waters at a cancer support group. Augustus is good-looking, in remission, and shockingly to Hazel, he's interested in her. So let's take a look at the trailer to see. The movie's coming out, I believe, this summer.
I believe we have a choice in this world about how to tell sad stories. On the one hand, you can sugarcoat it. When nothing is too messed up that can't be fixed with a Peter Gabriel song. I like that version as much as the next girl does. It's just not the truth. This is the truth.
Hey, make some friends.
Sorry.
My bad.
I'm Augustus Waters. I've been in remission for about a year and a half.
Maybe you'd like to share some of your fears with the group.
My fears? Oblivion. What's your name?
Hazel.
What's your full name?
Hazel Grace Lancaster. Why are you staring at me?
Because you're beautiful. So, what's your story?
I was diagnosed when I was 13.
Oh, no.
Your real story.
I am quite unextraordinary.
I reject that at the hand.
You know, Gus talks about you all the time.
We're just friends.
I hope you realize you're trying to keep your distance from me in no way lessens my affection for you.
Gus, I'm a grenade. One day I'm going to blow up, and I'm going to obliterate everything in my wake, and I don't want to hurt you.
You don't get to choose if you get hurt in this world, but you do have a say in who hurts you.
I am in love with you,
Hazel Grace.
And I know that love is just a shout into the void and that oblivion is inevitable.
And I am in love with you.
All your efforts to keep me from you are gonna fail.
Are you angry?
So angry.
You need to break something.
Gave me a forever with him in numbered days, and I can't tell you how thankful I am for our little infinity.
It's a good life, Hazel Grace.
Okay.
Okay.
Let's move on to historical fiction with our former history teacher, Mr. Hartley.
So my first historical fiction title is called Impossible Knife of Memory by Laurie Halls Anderson. It's the story of Haley and her dad. Her dad is a veteran of both the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, and they're settling down after about 5 years on the road where he was a truck driver and kind of homeschooled Haley, who's now 17. Now they're settling back down to kind of a normal life, get her back to school, etc. So it's her struggle to kind of adjust to that, but also his struggle. The real backdrop of the story is his struggle with post-traumatic stress disorder after his time in the military, and he battles alcoholism as well. So Haley kind of has to assume the role of caretaker a little bit for her dad, you know, meanwhile dealing with her own kind of issues. Although that backstory is kind of heavy and it's definitely dark at times, the book definitely contains some lighter elements, which revolve mostly around her relationship with a boy at school and her best friend, Gracie. And secondly, on my historical fiction, loosely on historical fiction list, is Time Bound, the Kronos Files by Risa Walker. This is sort of part science fiction, dystopian, and part historical fiction. It involves time travel, the story does. So from the future to the present and to the past. The past includes a stop in 1893 at the Chicago World's Fair, where a real serial killer in real life named H.H. Holmes was on the loose. And so that kind of gets woven into the story. Like any good time travel story, there are always issues with tampering with the past, because what impact that tampering might have on the future. And we have a trailer for Time Bound.
Miss LaCrosse, what do you like for historical fiction?
My historical fiction picks were your typical historical fiction books. My first one's called The Dark Between, and it's set in the Victorian era, and the plot revolves around psychic abilities. So three teens come together to solve a mystery after several dead bodies surface on the campus where they're staying that summer. They embark on their own investigation that is full of suspense and danger after one of the girls gains clues about a scientist's dangerous experiments from her ability to see and hear the dead. And my second pick is called Etiquette and Espionage. This action-packed book is often described as an 1850s version of Harry Potter. The story stars a girl who's attending finishing school in a world where vampires and werewolves are part of daily life. At the academy, the students don't just learn proper curtsies, but how to be spies and assassins as well. The adventure comes in when the newest girl at the academy assigns herself and a misfit crew to a dangerous mission which will help save the future and safety of this school.
Sounds interesting. A lot of people are looking for things to read after Harry Potter, I think. My list begins with a book called Codename Verity by Elizabeth Wine, and this one is a Prince Honor book. It's a New York Times bestseller, and it's a 2014 Nutmeg nominee. It's kind of a spy tale thriller. It's a story of two young British women, Maddie and Queenie, or is her name Julie, who undertake a secret mission behind enemy lines in occupied France in 1943. The novel begins as a confession that's being written by Queenie while she's being held prisoner of the Gestapo. And clearly her mission has gone terribly wrong. So let's take a look at the trailer to get a feel for this one. You know, I really enjoyed learning about the British female air corps during World War II in this book, and the author, Elizabeth Wine, is a pilot herself, so the scenes were really authentic. The second one that I chose for historical fiction is called The Roundhouse by Louise Erdick. Again, this one was a National Book Award finalist and a 2014 Nutmeg nominee as well, and this one's been described as a modern To Kill a Mockingbird. It's a book about justice and human nature, good and evil. In the summer of 1988, a Native American woman is raped somewhere in the vicinity of a sacred roundhouse, and seeking justice for the crime has become almost as devastating as the crime itself. The roundhouse stands on reservation land that's in North Dakota, where tribal courts are in charge, but the suspect is white, and tribal courts can't prosecute non-Native people. So when he hears that the judge handling the case isn't certain whether the accused man can be charged at all, the woman's teenage son pursues his own quest for justice.
It's an intense book, and you get a real flavor for Native American issues in this one. Miss Ortiz, you're up.
We get asked for a lot of war books at the library, so I just wanted to talk about Invasion by Walter Dean Myers quickly. It's actually a prequel. Some of you may have heard of Fallen Angels or Sunrise Over Fallujah, and this is the prequel to those two stories. So it's May 1944, and World War II is going on, and the story follows two friends who find themselves set to land on Omaha Beach, which was part of the Normandy invasion, often seen as the beginning of the Allied drive to free Europe from the Nazis. And for the past several weeks, everyone has been training for the landing on the beach, but no one thinks it's really going to be that bad. They kind of think that the Germans are just going to surrender and won't be any heavy fighting. But nothing can prepare the two friends and the fellow soldiers when they actually land on Omaha Beach. So this is definitely an action novel, and it's an accurate look at just the nature of war in itself. And then my second choice was to go along with spying and the assassins, was The Agency, A Spy in the House. And it starts off with the main character, Mary, being set to hang, actually. She's 12 years old, and that's how the book opens. She's a thief, and she's actually not that sad about it because her life has been hard, so she's kind of just sort of prepared. But then she's rescued, which is a shock to her, and brought to this academy for girls. And she receives all the proper education, fine manners, and then she gets this opportunity when she's 17 to become part of the agency, which the school is actually a cover for the agency, which is a top secret unit of female investigators. So her first job is to infiltrate this household, kind of see what's going on. There's some cargo that has gone missing from the merchant. And, of course, she can't help herself. She kind of gets involved more than she should, and there's actually murders that are occurring, so she gets involved with that. So it's a good murder mystery, but there's also a little bit of romance as well.
Sounds interesting. Well, that brings us to our final category, which is science fiction and fantasy, and we'll start off with Miss LaCrosse for this one.
Life as We Knew It is one of my favorite science fiction books. When a meteor hits the moon and throws off its orbit, disaster occurs. Miranda tells her story of survival through journal entries as her family faces a world where food, warmth, and well-being have disappeared in the blink of an eye. Will her and her family survive wild storms, crazy temperatures, and outbreaks of disease in the confined quarters of their home as they watch supplies dwindle and wonder whether there will be any future to make their efforts worthwhile? You'll have to read to find out. And my second pick, which I'm sure we've all heard of from the movie, is The Maze Runner. Boys come to the glade with no memory of how they got there or their prior lives. The boys lock themselves into the glade every night to avoid the grievers, creatures that are part machine, part animal, and altogether deadly. Each day, the boys send out runners to find a way out of the maze that surrounds them without success. But one day, the elevator delivers a girl with a message. She is the last teen to be sent, and there will be no more deliveries of food or supplies. Now that the glade is cut off and the grievers have gathered for an all-out attack, it's clear they must solve the maze. And we have the trailer for this one.
And shine.
What is this place?
Can you tell me your name?
I can't remember anything.
Who put us here? We don't know.
What's out there?
The maze.
Every morning when those doors open,
the runners look for a way out. And no one has ever survived a night in the maze.
What happens to them?
We don't belong here.
I think it's time we find out what we're really up against.
Everything started changing the moment you showed up.
It's a girl.
Thomas.
Why are we different?
What if we were sent here for a reason?
You're not like the others. You're curious.
you want to stay here, I need to know that you're going to follow the rules.
Pretty sure that that's a series book as well, and like a lot of the science fiction and fantasy, my two choices are series books. The first one is book two of the Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children series, and I know I book talked that one a couple of years ago. Hollow City is the sequel. In Hollow City, the Peculiars, which are the children who have unusual powers, are on the move to London to find a cure for Miss Peregrine, who's been trapped in her bird form, but time is running short. So even if the teens reach London alive, will it be enough to save Miss Peregrine? So they're continuing to move through loops, time loops, and they have the dangerous whites and hollow casts always close by. So it's a suspenseful, sort of scary but humorous and touching story. And like the first book in the series, it's a little quirky because it's filled with these odd vintage photographs that Riggs has collected from flea markets and archives, and he weaves them into the stories. And I know there'll be a third in that series. And 20th Century Fox is making a Tim Burton-directed movie, which I think they're going to call Miss Pig. The second one that I have is Unholy by Neil Schusterman, and this is book two of the Unwind Distology. In the first book, we followed a group of teenagers that were running from being unwound, which is retroactively aborted by your parents. And at the end of the book, the three main characters, Connor, Lev, and Risa, had led a revolt at one of the largest harvest camps. So Unholy begins with the impact of those actions, and unwinding has become a huge business, and there are powerful political and corporate interests that want to see it continue and expand into the unwinding of prisoners and the poor. We also meet a new character in this one named Cam, and Cam is the product of all unwound parts. So it's a person, I guess, that's never been born, but only made up of the parts of others. And so he's a sort of futuristic Frankenstein's monster. And so there's a struggle with, you know, what makes us human? You know, does this being have a soul? Really interesting ideas here. And a sadistic bounty hunter provides the suspense as the book really challenges assumptions about where life begins and ends. Bailey, what about you?
I chose Uninvited by Sophie Jordan. It takes place in the distant future where future killers can actually be identified with a gene test. So the main character, Davy, has everything, a boyfriend, she's going to be homecoming queen, she has a future at Juilliard, but she loses it all when her genetic testing comes back positive for the kill gene. So she's uninvited from her prestigious school, and she's avoided by her friends and family, and she hasn't done anything, it's just that her test came back positive. So there's that question of how much control do your genetics come into being, and I do have just a quick book trailer about that.
The Attorney General has issued an order for all citizens of the United States to be tested for homicidal tendency syndrome.
I had all these dreams to become something. Someone. No one ever said I couldn't. No one ever said killer.
And a clear correlation between the HTS gene and convicted murders.
I'm the same girl I was yesterday. I'm no different. But somehow, I am. To them, I am.
Capital crime, the Attorney General says.
I don't know what my future holds anymore. I don't know anything. Except what I am. What I'm not. Not a killer.
We advise you to treat carriers with extreme caution as their actions are unpredictable.
My next book is Phoenix Island by John Dixon. Carl is an up-and-coming boxer who's won a national championship. He's actually won 85 out of 87 of his fights, but he can never stand by and watch when someone's being bullied, and that sort of has led to a big issue with him. He can't help himself. He's been in and out of the juvenile justice system. And now at 16, he's finally being sent to what they call Phoenix Island. And it's supposed to be this isolated boot camp, but turns out more to be this mercenary training facility, turning these throwaway children, so to speak, into scientifically enhanced killers. So now Carl has to stop a madman bent on destroying the world.
Oh. And finishing it out is Mr. Hartley.
Yes, my one title on the sci-fi list is actually a zombie book, which is typically Miss Ortiz's domain. The Reapers Are the Angels by Alden Smith, another Nutmeg Award nominee. Really descriptive writing and interesting characters throughout this book. It's set about 25 years after zombies have risen and taken over the country. So the main character, Temple, who's only 15, has only lived in this world, has only experienced the post-zombie apocalypse world. So she's used to this kind of just struggle to survive day in and day out. So it reads very much like kind of an episode of The Walking Dead. It feels that way, at least a lot to me. But there's also a lot of attention paid to Temple's internal kind of struggle to make meaning in this, you know, obviously a harsh world, and very lonely world as well. And I have a short trailer for that as well.
I know that one of the series that we've all found to be very popular with our patrons this year has been the Divergent series, especially with the completion of Allegiant, which people had mixed reviews on. But, you know, why the series is so popular, you know, it's got everything: strong female character, a world that's trying to stifle individuality. It's got tension, it's got adventure, there's a love interest. So this is one that I think is going to be popular over the summer as well,
especially with the movie coming out.
Yeah,
that's this summer, right?
Actually, it's rumored to come out July 8th, and we're hoping to have a party at the library with trivia and prizes and all that, and a viewing of the movie, as long as it sticks to the schedule.
Perfect. All right, then we're gonna wrap things up here. You can check out the NHS Facebook page for any updates, and also see our summer reading assignments posted on the NHS Library LibGuides. We're also going to be sending copies of all of the titles that we own over to Lucy Robbins Welles for the summer so that students can borrow them there. And I think the public library also has a summer reading program this summer.
Yep, just quickly, we kind of changed it this year, so it's very simple. You earn prize tickets for if you read a book, if you volunteer, and that can be at home or in an actual place or for organization. If you write a review, and that can be a review on a book, movie, amusement park, video game, anything that you would like. And then the last one was, I forget, but there's one more that you can do. There's four things you can do, and you get prize tickets, and then we have weekly raffles, so you can earn $25 to Amazon, the mall, iTunes, Best Buy. We have some biggie tickets, things like that. And we're going to leave some pamphlets here at the school library if you're interested.
Great. Super. Well, we wish everybody a safe and happy summer, and we hope you read something really enjoyable this summer.